comfortable.
Okay, draft one is underway. Let's find out who has more weird.
I think Ehom's one of the few Eastern teams that don't fear a Stardar from a Western team.
Why do you think that is?
Because they have that Abaddon, they have sometimes the Treant Protector.
They don't feel the Slava, they just feel theirs.
I mean, they led it through the last time. I was like, okay. We haven't really seen a solution to it, though.
They beat Vichy Gaming with it.
I think it's been one of Moonmeander's best heroes.
I agree.
Alright. And similarly, Ehom has been getting Tusk an awful lot.
Guys, I want to hear some secret espionage information that I heard in the shuttle this morning. So I was driving to the event, Moonmander's in the vehicle with me, and he said, anytime Ehom gets Tusk, Ehom just automatically wins, okay? So, but there's two issues. I can't remember things very well, and my hearing's not very good, so it might have been a different team. But just keep that in mind. If they get Tusk, there's a... Well,
they won't get Tusk.
So maybe you misheard it.
What I don't like about those Wisp pick up first is the fact that they're going to pick Tiny now. I'm pretty sure Ehom's going to go with the Tiny.
They play Bristleback a lot, too. I don't really think they're scared of the Tiny Wisp.
No, but do they pick it? No, they don't. Okay, so Tiny instead.
With all the Tiny we've seen...
So this will be Tiny.
Ehom play, I'm surprised they don't pick it up now.
I don't think it works that well for them, and I think they want to know what they're playing against, which is IO Tiny.
I mean, they're in the loser bracket final. I'm pretty sure it works pretty well for them.
Of course it does.
That's true.
But, I don't know. Maybe
in previous matches.
Maybe Ehom want them to pick it.
Yeah.
Maybe they have
a... Did they not pick it against CDC yesterday?
What, OG? Yeah, they did.
Yeah.
That was the pooled Aghanim setup.
Yeah.
I like the Dragonite ban a lot. It prevents the setup that Ancient Apparition and Queen of Pain would follow up on, and it's also the straightforward tanky core draft that Ehom goes for.
I'd be more scared of the Bristle. I would want to ban Bristle if I'm OG, though, because I think Ehom run that hero way more than the Dragonite.
But I feel like it's not quite synergizing with the draft that Ehom started with. When you go AA, you're looking for a stun setup that's also tanky. And yeah, Bristle's super tanky and good at staying alive, but he doesn't set up that combo.
But he's also much better versus Wisp Tiny, though. I think I've seen Dragonites just like feed versus that combo, whereas Bristle's just much more tanky. I mean, usually they draft the setup as their offlaner, though. I've seen his Nyx before. His Tusk was much better. I don't know what other setups there are, though.
What do you think of the first ban from Ehom in the second phase?
Respect.
Did IO Tiny still on the board?
It's true. It wasn't necessary, I think.
Hmm. Don't want to take chances.
Yeah, you may as well not.
Especially against Queen of Pain and Ancient Apparition. Neither of those heroes can deal with it very well.
Mm-hmm. I like the AA pickup early on just because it pretty much prevents the Shadow Priest. I think
OG's and the Huskar.
And the Huskar, exactly. But I think OG is going to go for the Shadow Priest regardless of a hero we forgot about, Doombringer.
Yep.
So 2 weeks ago that would have been unheard of, but nowadays it's just not that good anymore. I mean, the hero is still good. Yeah. It just hasn't worked really well.
Yeah, it's been let through an awful lot. Brood also banned. So, less crazy.
Yeah, I don't think there's any cheese left from OG. There's Tiny, Brood's been banned, Meepo's been banned, Huskar is countered by AA. Do they have anything else?
Do they go for...
I think Wisp is already decent versus Doom, though. I'm just worried about the Wisp sense. Just blowing up to the Queen of Pain.
Undyne gives them pretty good pressure possibility for any Ehom safe lane. They could also do early aggression with IO plus Undyne. Doesn't necessarily have to stay in the same lane as the Tiny. Tiny could passively farm. Not against the Queen, for example, but maybe some other lanes. And this also covers them too. If Doom previously could have maybe Doomed IO, prevented healing in that way. Now they've got a second source with Undyne. We saw Soul Rips in the last game. They were amazing. 6 second cooldown, you can heal for like
400. Yay, more heals versus AA.
Okay, if A lands his Ice Blast, yes.
Yeah,
but if he doesn't, Doom does nothing.
Yes. But they still don't have the setup that you're talking about, so it is a very realistic possibility that he will not get good Ice Blast off.
Centaur Creep?
Pearl Boulder?
The 0.6 stun.
What other things have we seen to counter IO? We've seen Bounty Hunter a decent amount to deal with the IO. Ehom runs it a decent amount, but still no real setup for them.
I don't like it versus Tiny either. It's just too low HP. It'll die the one shot consistently. Go with the Wind Ranger.
A very normal draft coming up from Eho.
Mm-hmm. So I guess that's their setup, Shackle Shot.
Seems reasonable enough.
Still feel like Eholm's pretty countered by a Force Staff right now. And a little bit of healing.
They have a well-rounded lineup if they finish it off with like an Earthshaker or something. It doesn't really necessarily hard counter anything, but it's just great throughout all stages of the game. We don't see much Earthshaker in the tournament. As opposed to, as compared to how much we usually saw it.
Yeah.
23 games so far, Frank's out major.
Okay, that's a decent amount of games.
Yeah, 60.9% win rate too.
That's a really good win rate.
So what are we looking at for Moon? Do they need a setup of their own for the Tiny Wisp, or are they looking to play more defensive / team fight with perhaps like a Darkseer, or is it more Scout with Beastmaster?
I mean, you said Nyx was, you didn't like Moon's Nyx, but it's a pretty good
No, not Moon. 11's Nyx.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Sorry.
I think a Nyx would be pretty good. You could scout out IO Tiny ganks. It's a Queen of Pain and a Wind Ranger core. Wind Ranger doesn't have the most int because she doesn't build tons of int items, but Mana Drain would be good there. It's a good hero to solo kill Ancient Apparition. I feel like there's pretty good solutions. Doom has Scorched Earth, so you can pop Spike Carapace to get a setup. I feel like it's a decent hero here. It doesn't synergize well with Undyne in the dual offline, though, is the only
I was thinking of the Earthshaker for Eholm's lineup, but it's, considering it's OG, I actually think it's more likely that they might pick it up. And as I say that, they pick up a Nightstalker.
Moon's been playing offline Nightstalker, very good.
Well, so far, this has been a relatively quiet draft in comparison to the way these two have drafted in previous games.
Gotta feel them out the first game.
Until we get to the last pick.
It's very well within OG's comfort zone right now, and that's what we sort of expected as well. That they have these go-to strategies that they seem to lean towards, whereas Eholm, you never really know what to expect. Giving CCY Queen of Pain, though, is a bit ominous.
Agreed. I just think they have a lot of bursts to kill the IO. I'm still really scared for his life. If they can actually protect him with these three melee lines.
They don't have very good counters to co-op in the early game either, so.
Nightstalker?
I mean, that's their one solution, right? It's either that or you tiny combo him.
Blink Dagger Tiny, yeah. I think they have decent. They have
but
two
what
heroes
about
that.
Before the blink, and what about like pre level 4 Nightstalker, you know?
I mean, that's very early on.
So, Bounty Hunter is locked in. For Eheon, final pick for OG.
You need a miracle hero.
The Bounty Hunter can disrupt the stacks early if OG decide to play too greedily or draft too greedy lanes.
It's one of the best win rates here at Frankfurt, 77.8%.
You think they could go for the Alchemist again? It is up against an AA this time around.
If he's not playing as the core, if he's doing the same like mass armor strat like he did before with like AC and Solar Crest, I think it's not the worst thing to have that counter be in the game. Gives him a stun, gives him a ton of minus armor, and Eholm's pretty weak across the board at receiving physical damage. They don't have much armor there.
And with the Earthshaker Band, they might pull off the same strategy we saw in game one against CDC yesterday.
Does Miracle play Invoker?
Yes, he plays an amazing Invoker, actually. I had the utmost displeasure of playing up against it on in ranked matchmaking, and he completely demolished me. It's a bit of an unfair matchup.
Were you 1v1?
I had 4 Russians on my team.
And the 4 Russians were like, yeah, we had Melk on our team. And it's an Ember Spirit to finish things off. So we head into game one of the lower bracket final. Eholm versus OG. It's all yours. Catalyst and Blitz.
Thank you, Paul. Chinese Dota is doomed. At least that's what old Chicken spouted earlier today in his post-victory interview. But it seems like it's actually going to be OG that is doomed repeatedly in this game, as they have the Tiny Wisp and an Ember Spirit picked up against the Doom Blitz. Is that going to be enough to stop this track hold from spiraling out of control?
I don't know, because we saw yesterday that Kaka plays one of the better bounty hunters in the pro Dota scene. I know we kind of throw that term around a lot where we say X player is just the amount of impact that he's able to have. It really matches the up-tempo style that Ehome bring consistently. But as far as the Ember Spirit, the Tiny Wisp goes, it's pretty good. You have to kind of doom the Wisp sometimes, just because if you doom the Tiny, then the Wisp will just keep you alive forever.
All right, starting this first game off between OG and Ehome, determining who's going to be able to have the chance to go up against Evil Geniuses in the lower bracket finals. OG starting things off with their three heroes. Nightstalker, Wisp, and Tiny all heading up to that top rune. OG actually splitting themselves a bit with the Ember Spirit and Undying at the bottom lane. Looks like we may have a level 1 fight on our hands. Old 11 is going to be making his way into that AoE jungle, see if he can't spout out anything. Kaka's actually going to be able to get a decent ward here. Looks like Undetected is that will be blocking out the pull, I believe.
Yeah, something we talked about before the draft was how does a team like OG manage to get their Wisps and Tiny, but it's just because they have such a wide variety of heroes that they're known for. For example, the Slardar, I feel like, is a hero that you simply can't give them. Miracle on Radiant side with the Shadow Fiend is also a hero that you can't really give up.
Oh, no tail. This is not going to be working again in this tournament, I don't think. It's DTY.
No, he's got Blink.
Yeah, even if he does get tossed up, he'll have the Blink, so he should be totally fine. But look where Kaka's at. He's going to be waiting for that early pickoff on the Courier.
Yeah, if he times this right, if he actually waits on the right side of things, which I think he might, because a lot of teams expect this snipe, so they send the Courier around.
Oh, Courier dancing around. And Kaka, he knows. It's been spoiled. OG saw that one coming a mile away, and Crit is going to head back to base in order to pick up that salve for himself.
Still, I think it's worth the effort at least to at least try and do that, but really well played by OG. But this mid matchup, it's going to be okay for the Windranger early on, but as they start to get levels, she should struggle.
Crit's also going to be stacking up. Of course, Radiant side advantage. The Wisp can easily stack up camps for the Tiny, so we should see ourselves a pretty fast. Is this going to be a Blink Dagger game for our Tiny? Just try and get nice and aggressive on some of these squishier cores like Windranger and Queen of Pain?
I think so. The interesting part, though, is that when you have a lineup like OG's, you do want a team fight, just because you have the Undying, the Nightstalker, you've got a lot of vision, and most importantly, you've got a ton of Burst Nuke, but it's going to be quite scary fighting into the Bounty Hunter. One fight goes awry, you give up two or three track kills, everything goes the other way.
Right now, Kaka's trying to create space for Old 11, and he seems to be getting almost total free farm here. 4CS already on the board for him, and Miracle dropping a bit of regen. Meanwhile, in the top lane, Moon is actually not faring that good. He's still not level 2, as Lanham's Ancient Apparition and CTY's Queen of Pain is more than enough to force him out of lane repeatedly. Bottom lane, they're going to continue to go on to Miracle here. They're going to try and chase him down as best as possible. Kaka waits out his invisibility for a little while. They're going to strike again soon, but the Soul Rip is going to keep Miracle pretty healthy. And Kaka won't be able to go for this dive. Janata, maybe he will. If he needs two more hits, he's going to dive into that. Our healing salve keeps him alive. And Kaka's going to drop dangerously low here right outside the tower. But fortunately, no counter vision from OG to give away that first blood.
I still think it's worth it, though, for him to go for that one extra right click just because of the fact that he was able to pop the salve. The Bounty Hunter isn't as necessary in this lane. And that was the last tango that the Ember Spirit has. This is the kind of pressure that you want to put in the off lane. Going for an outright kill might be a little bit unrealistic because they don't have a disable.
Oh, they
but
don't.
Simply zoning
oh,
out.
They have the combination now. Old Chicken is going to be caught as Moon Meander reveals the Invis rune that he picked up. Huge amount of body blocking here, but underneath this tier 1 tower, Old Chicken turns around to go for the power shot, but it's first blood that goes to Moon Meander.
Such a nice rotation by him. And this is something that they have to expect. Is that Moon, if he's going to be zoned out of the top lane by the Queen of Pain, this is the best possible thing for him to do. Control the runes, try to put some pressure on mid. The Windranger does have Windrun, but it's deceptive because it doesn't last for very long at the first level, only 3 seconds. And with a combo like Tiny Wisp, you can chase for quite some time.
Moon Meander still going to be pushed away by Lanham. He's not getting up to that top lane just yet, but He will be looking to probably rotate again around that 4 minute mark, not only rune spawning then, but also that precious nighttime.
And they're actually going to give a lot of this XP in the jungle to the Wisp, but the one downside is he went for the stack again, unable to get it because there is a sentry ward down, and this is the strength of the bounty hunter. He can control up your jungle so well by just being alive.
At least Crit's going to be able to deny a decent amount of experience away from the Wind Ranger with this pull. Tried it once before, failed, but second time is the charm for Crit.
They need to give him some of the solo XP and the...
They're going to go into Moon Meander, who has a TP scroll and will immediately jump out. Thanks to that early first blood, he's already got Boots of Speed and Blades of Attack, so this could be very early phase boots for a Night Stalker that's been completely shut out of lane.
I think he might decide to go for a gank, but this is a little bit risky. I think the Wind Ranger is a little bit more aware now that it's nighttime, and Moon's going to try to create a little bit of space for his team. He's only level 2, though, and the power shot might have just spotted that.
This bottom lane, the choice to go for counter wards here, do you think that was the correct decision by Fly rather than Dust?
Yeah, I think so. You never really know where Kaka's going to be. It's better to have that sentry vision. Like, they might even set up for a kill right here because of it.
Yep, they're going to get him. They lock him down to the Jackals. Looks like Kaka will be a second death on E-Home. OG rotating their full force of the middle lane into that bottom in order to catch out the Bounty Hunter, making the score now 2-0.
We saw it pay off almost immediately right there. If Fly goes for the Dust, they might not even have kill potential onto the Bounty Hunter because there is the Doom right there. So it's much better for them to just go for the vision play. And with the help of Moon Meander, it leads to a kill, but mid...
Wind Ranger is going to be taking a lot of magic damage here. The Wind Run has run out. And Moon Meander picks up yet another kill. His rotating Night Stalker is out of control. He didn't get anything in that top lane, but it's creating all the space in the world at middle and bottom.
Yeah, this is something that E-Home should at least be wary about because it is nighttime. The Night Stalker doesn't have anything to gain from that top lane, and CTY can call back when he rotates. During this time period, you want to see the Wind Ranger be a little bit more defensive. I feel like the Bounty Hunter death right there is a little bit more acceptable, but the one in death, the one in mid, again, the Wind Run, level 1, it just won't keep you alive. This is a really deceptive lane because you look at it and you say, okay, if you can survive the combo, you wouldn't run away. But the slow from the tether is usually enough to chase out. And with the help of Moon Meander, they're getting that kill every single time.
E-Home being punished for giving OG their signature picks, but they still have the CTY Queen of Pain, which is now level 6, has a TP scroll ready to go. And I'm sure the next clash that happens near Tier 1 tower, CTY will report in for E-Home.
Whether it remains to be seen if this laning decision will work out for E-Home, because they could have just put the Queen of Pain mid, and that is quite a good matchup for the Queen of Pain. Because anytime they decide to go on you, you can simply blink out.
Gonna try and catch Moon Meander, but once again, he's just gonna TP out the Sonic Wave, though! CTY will commit that one to get the first kill on the board for E-Home.
There's no way that they're gonna let him get away in a situation like that, especially with the ultimate.
Radiance top. Night Stalker's already been out of control. CTY is now going to try and push down that tier 1 tower as best as possible, but it's mid lane.
He's already expended it.
Chicken once again. They're going to catch him out with the next combo. The toss is up. They just need the vision to be able to catch him. He's juking around the trees, but won't make it far. No Tail gets his hands on the Wind Ranger and takes her apart. Next up, Old Chicken's going to go for crit now. It's a level 4 whiz. Nice juke around. Kaka can't actually hit the Janata hit. Now No Tail stands and fights on the front line, making sure that Old 11 can't do anything, misses the avalanche, and Kaka's still trying to catch up to crit, but he's just a bit too fast.
And you saw the problem right there is that Old 11, he thought about dooming the tiny for half a second, but he knows for a fact he has to go for crit in that situation. If he's unable to catch up to crit, there's no way that they're going to get the kill. And once again, like I've said, Old Chicken, he's got to learn from this. You've got to play reactively a little bit more. Because every single time you step out on the slow ground and the Wisp is there, they're going to go for the chase, even if you have the Wind Run available, because the cooldown from the toss is so low.
Night Stalker setting up for one more gank before nighttime ends. But it looks like Old Chicken, is he going to be playing passively enough this time? Looks like he's just throwing out power shots and that's about it. They're pinning him out, but he's going to head towards that bottom lane to try and get the 8-minute rune. He'll be met with both Miracle and Fly, though. The counter ward already being laid out. They spotted Kaka. They might be able to get the Avalanche on the invis target, but it's not going to be worth it. Instead, they're going to turn their sights towards Old Chicken. Once again, locking him down. Will be able to pop him with all that magic damage. Old 11's going to be up next. Pops the ice armor, but he's surrounded by five heroes. There's no way out of this one, as he's just going to slowly but surely be taken down by the nukes. Old 11 down is just 50 HP. The nuke comes in. Void is what finishes.
Oh, he doesn't have mana.
He's going to be next up. He doesn't have mana for the invis. Three more mana is all he needs, but Mango Pop toss in the air. Kaka goes down.
And oh, now they're going to go for more
as well. Miracle wants to be able to get the chains on him, but they back out. CTY is here. And once again, Moon Meander will make the defensive TP play. CTY is moving forward, though, and with the power shot hitting on three, he wants to come forward. Hits the Sonic Wave. Shackle Shot locking down two. OG will end up losing two of their heroes for overextending, and they might just lose Miracle as well. He has a Remnant, gets uphill. Very low HP. Old 11, though, won't be able to catch up, but maybe CTY can. He has a regen rune as well. 8 seconds until his next blink is up. The power shot giving him some information. CTY wants to make the dive so desperately, but Crit is here. And if he makes the dive now, it's going to be all for naught. Old Chicken does reveal, hits the two of them. But Queen of Pain, he's already given up on that.
Yeah, especially when he sees the Wisp. There's no way that he's going to go for that. He's just going to puff the regen. And they want to make a move for this bottom tower, but they don't have Doom available, nor do they have the Queen of Pain ultimate. Luckily for them, No-Tail decides to TP mid. Moon's going to go for
prospect. Miracle's going to make himself the target immediately because he has Flame Guard already up, bounces back with Remnant now. Now they have a Tombstone out, but Ehom address it immediately. They pick up the kill on the Ember Spear. Now they're going to look for more as Fly's going to be chased away.
No way Fly's going
to
live.
Grit, he has a tether. He's going to get away to the side, but no! The Queen of Pain nuke follows him, and three go down for OG. Ehom taking rapid control of this game that was kind of one-sided in the first few minutes.
It definitely was, but their decision to go for this five-man bottom and OG's decision to not contest it whatsoever is going to make this really easy for them. There must have been some miscommunication by OG, because they knew that, or they would have at least had some idea that a lot of Ehom members were still at bottom lane.
Mm-hmm.
But they had time as well. Like, No-Tail made the decision to TP. I agree with that, but if you're going to go for that move, the rest of your team has to get out.
Oh, the Ice Blast is coming in. Moon Meander's going to try and TP out. The Ice Blast does land, but it looks like he will still be fine. Is the tick damage? Well, he's actually got Shadow Strike. He's dead. He's going to be dying in the fountain. Here is the Ice Blast. No, he barely lives through it. One more tick, and that would have been the end of him to that 10% marker, but Moon Meander lucky to be alive. 7-7 OG. They're going to try and stop the momentum of Ehom now with the three-man smoke.
Yeah, Moon Meander at that last second decides to buy that cloak. Immediately sells it once the tick down doesn't hit him.
Oh, great call.
Yeah, they might actually just run into CTY. Does he have time?
Oh, he gets hit by the avalanche. The toss is there. They still need a couple more nukes. Crit, he didn't get the ball control in. And CTY,
they might still go for this.
Sneak away with 60 HP, but there's more TPs coming out for Ehom. And Ice Blast on its way. Queen of Pain turns around, goes for the Sonic Wave, but he doesn't get it off. The Ice Blast misses on Crit. He's hiding to the side. He's got to relocate. He's going to try and get out of here by himself. No, can't make it. He ends up going down as Old 11 traps him in, but well worth it as they got CTY's Queen of Pain.
Being able to get that kill spree means so much for them. He decides to just blink out to the left as soon as he's got the range for it, but might have had more success if he was able to just blink in the trees. He didn't have a TP either, though. It was such a rough decision for him.
Oh, Kaka, he got spotted by the counter. We're just on the edges of it, though. And he will be able to escape.
I think they're just trying to create some space for Miracle right now. Who's had some tough times at that bottom lane. But the Wisp Tiny is still really strong.
It's 8-8 right now, but net worth wise, it's actually a bit in favor of Ehom at 3,500 gold. Helps that they have that tier 1 tower advantage. Old Chicken's going to be picked up here, taken out. The combination too strong, but CTY,
oh, this might be it.
It's going to be a double. No Tails first to go. Crit falls up with the Ice Blast. Miracle comes in. It's recompense, though. He's going to be able to get at least CTY's in silence. Make sure he goes down. Bottoms up next. Miracle gets the double kill in return. A bounce back and forth starts with the Wind Ranger's death, goes to OG, but in the end, it's going to be Miracle who cleans up the rest.
And this is going to really help his net worth. At some point, he was behind the Night Stalker with that double kill.
Oh, and it's not even the last lap. Moon Meander is actually going to be able to get Kaka here thanks to the dust. He wants that kill for himself. And it looks like he's actually... Is this a Midas?
I think it is. He's quite close to it. 13 minutes in. For a hero that was quite far behind, this is perfectly fine. We've seen him do this on the Slardar. earlier into the tournament when he gets behind in the offlane. His gold is okay, but the number one thing that you want to worry about with a hero like Nightstalker, especially when you were behind in the early game, is the levels. A lot of people think that it's simply just for the gold, but when you've got an offlane hero, the ability to keep up with levels while ganking, this item kind of fits both those needs.
Yeah, if you just compare him levels and even in a way network to some of the cores of Ehome, he is a bit dramatically behind, especially Old 11 and CTY, who's now topping out the board at 5,700. The rotation's coming out here in the top lane. Old 11, he's a tanky bird though. They're going to try and go for him, but the shackle comes in. Old 11, he's lined up for another stun for the Centaur stun, but it's the silence that keeps him away from being able to lock down No-Tail further. Now the Tombstone is going to force Ehome back, and OG are going to be the ones searching for it, trying to get another combination. Ren, then jump in. Miracle wants to be able to catch on him. They'll get him at least, but No-Tail's the response as Old 11 locked him down. Crit's actually keeping No-Tail alive, and Old 11 can't pursue. He's now looking towards Fly.
Miracle doesn't have a spirit.
But Miracle doesn't have a way out. Old 11 finds that one, turns around, and claims at least one. The power shot brought No-Tail a bit low. But in the end, it's a two for nothing as Miracle couldn't even get the kill on Lana.
That could have been even worse for OG. But that's the issue when you decide to doom up the Tiny. You do take him out of the fight, but the chances of you killing No-Tail there are almost nil.
Oh, the Ice Blast is coming in. It will clip Crit, but they want to catch No-Tail here. CTY jumps forward. Crit, are you going to be able to save him with the Relocate? The Sonic Wave comes out. No-Tail's still alive. Relocate out, and No-Tail back to the fountain. They keep him alive, and Ehome committed pretty heavily for that one. Are they going to be sticking around? It looks like OG, they kind of want him to. Ehome to back out, though.
No, with all four, they're alive there. Fly can TP in as well. No chance that Ehome decides to continue to take that fight. And even though the score is even, the net worth advantage is pretty firmly in favor of Ehome right now. CTY's done such a good job of farming. He almost has that Orchid completed. And that's just another control factor for them. Especially when you're playing against a hero like Wisp.
Mm-hmm. The only one who's a bit behind is Old Chicken. Obviously, that mid lane wasn't real good for him. They're going to go on to Old 11 here. Silence up. Ice Blast is going to land on three, though. And that's an opportunity for Ehome to respond. No-Tail's low enough. The Power Shot finished him up. Miracle's going to be the next target. CTY finishes off the Night Stalker. TP. Looks for Miracle as well. He's got the Shadow Strike and the Gap Division. They'll get that kill.
Triple.
Fly goes down as well. Double the CTY. And he wants the triple. He has a blink up at three more seconds. And Crit, he doesn't really have a way out of here. Just the TP. They lost vision. And Ehome won't be able to claim that extra kill, but that was a buyback there on No-Tail, and he didn't really get anything for it.
I think he thought his team was in a much better situation. He immediately goes for the buyback because they have the tier 1 available. He knows that Ehome no longer does, but Ehome was there in full force. That could have been a triple kill for CTY as well. Almost 5 kills and a buyback expended.
And now the Wind Rangers
was able to get out.
That Wind Ranger's looking great. He's talking about her kind of being on the middling net worth, but now she's ahead of every single one of the cores of OG.
With that buyback expended and that one fight, this is definitely in Ehome's control now. Like, the score looks quite close, but the net worth is starting to steadily climb their way, and this Queen of Pain bounty hunter is going to get out of control.
The Orchid up. Queen of Pain, CTY, is going to go hunting now at the bottom lane. Tier 1 tower in the top lane will be left at deny range. Old 11, well, he's going to have a little ball of light tossed onto him. They turn around and immediately blow up the ball of light. His Crit, he's going to be healed up, but it doesn't look like that's going to be enough. No-Tail. Mercy. He takes out his ally in a deny against that Doom and also deny that tower. But Ehome walk away from the relocate pretty happy.
There's still a good chunk of change that was denied by OG. I really like that they decided to stick around in force. There's no real way for them to turn around that fight when it's not nighttime.
Miracle. He's going to have an itchy trigger finger on that fire remnant now that Old Chicken has the blink dagger. Got to be aware of those opportunities for Shackle Shot, because that'll oftentimes lead Old 11, or maybe just the raw nuking power of the Queen of Pain to claim the kill.
I do like that Old Chicken decided to go for the Blink Dagger. I think he realizes the rest of his cores are far enough ahead that he doesn't necessarily have to be the damage-dealing core that you'll normally see out of a mid-Wind Ranger. I think he understands that he's a little bit too far behind, so to go for the utility, it's a little bit stronger, especially since Old 11 is mainly building into a tank rather than an initiator himself.
Mm-hmm.
So they need something that can start the fight. That's the one downside of having a lineup with both the Bounty Hunter and the Ancient Apparition. You're going to lack disables by a little bit, so the positioning for the Windrunner's Shackle Shot is so huge.
The Vlad's picked up by the Doom. pretty standard at this point, but it is going to be extra useful for Ehome as their two other cores are actually heavy right-clickers, Queen of Pain even, with that Orchid build.
I think this early armor helps quite a bit for the rest of your team, too. Yeah. It neutralizes most of the damage from Sleight of Fist early on when you don't have items like the crit or the Battle Fury.
No Tail still trying to finish up that Blink Dagger. Is that still the choice, though? It's 20 minutes in. OG have fallen a bit behind. Does he still have the power to just combo down heroes?
It's getting harder and harder as the game goes on. There's enough HP on most of the heroes. Sans the Ancient Apparition, who's only got 739. But that's being played by Lanham. He's just going to play the positioning game every single time.
Right.
And as long as he's not in the middle of the fight grouped up, he should be perfectly okay. And they're going to give up this mid tower. They've already lost the bottom tier one as well. And what this usually means is you've got complete jungle control now as the Dire. This is the perfect situation to be in, because once you can get control of the jungle, going for the Roshan becomes that much easier.
Yeah, and you can see Ehome are already going to go for that one. They don't even need Ags on Windranger. Not necessary. They'll just group up with a Chilling Touch, and OG have no response.
OG saw the smoke, I think. It was in the middle of the creepway, but they thought that Ehome was going to go for the gank at bottom, so they all TP back, they all run away, and Ehome just says, well, that's not actually the objective here, we're going to go for the Roshan. And this is such a crucial pickup for them, because CTY relies, he actually thrives on being able to have this Aegis without the BKB.
Oh, Kaka actually runs into the two-man smoke here, and neither one of them have vision to get that Bounty Hunter, so that's another loss for OG. They couldn't stop that Aegis from being taken by Ehome. And they also wasted a smoke in the process.
CTY, he's up to 3,200 gold already in 19 minutes. And this guy's been a monster.
Pain? Do you start going the BKB AC route, or do you think the Aghanim still has plenty of value against like a Tiny and Wisp combo?
I think the Ags has a lot of merit this game. Usually, in this kind of position, you'll go for the BKB just because you're playing against heroes like the Night Stalker and the Ember Spirit. But because you have the Aegis, it allows you a little bit more wiggle room than you're normally used to.
Oh, miracle!
Ooh, the Shackle's still going to follow him, but he's perfectly fine.
So we will have the Blink Dagger build on No-Tail. This perhaps gives a bit more credence to the Aghanim's build on CTY, but he's going to go BKB, so again, he's just going to have to be ready to hit that one as soon as the Tiny shows himself, as Queen of Pain could actually just be blinked on and combo down.
I really like this CTY, because a lot of players in this position, when they have the Aegis, they would continue to try to go for the snowball, but CTY realizes this is kind of their moment. They're so far ahead right now, why not continue to snowball away? You're going to be the first one in the fight anyways. If you manage to lose the Aegis early on, and you die once again, without the BKB, you're feeding away quite a bit of gold. And with this BKB, there's almost nothing on OG that can really stop them.
They have no control whatsoever against a magic immune target.
So. I think they trust the amount of damage that they have. Otherwise, he might have gone for the Ags.
Yeah.
But it seems like he's pretty hard locked into this build every game.
Kaka gets spotted out here by Miracle. Just going to put himself even farther in the trees, and the Ice Blast is going to make things difficult for No-Tail. Looks like Ehome are just going to keep going, getting some damage on the Tier 3. Now they're going to TP back. Miracle wants to be able to finish off this tower, but he's caught by the Orchid now, and he may be going down. CTY starts ran up the Sonic Wave, gets it out now for the relocate. It doesn't save him. They get him back to base, but Ember Spirit ends up dying to the Orchid. No-Tail will be able to get out, but Miracle's kill was critical, and of course the Wisp, who made that relocate play all for nothing, as he's going to go down as well.
Great rotation in by Ehome. They don't even lose their tier 2 tower after taking that top one, and they managed to pick up two kills to go along with it. And this is huge, to be able to slow down the Ember further. This is going to make their high ground attempt that much easier. We saw how difficult it was for Team Secret to broach the high ground once the Ember Spirit had the Battle Fury. Eventually they were able to do so, but it took something like four Aegises.
Oh, Moon, he's hit by that Ice Blast, but CTY is not going to make his jump yet. He's sitting here on the side in Viz, trusting that he'll have a better opportunity in future time. Old Chicken, in the meanwhile, using the Focus Fire on that Tier 2 tower, bringing it down pretty quickly, and that's why No-Tail has to put a stop to that one, but unfortunately his combination isn't enough to finish up Old Chicken by itself.
You definitely don't want to continue to go for that chase either. OG, they've got to play defensively right now. And Lanham, he almost has that Aghanim Scepter completed. He's got that Hand of Midas. He's got the important piece of it with the point booster. And interestingly enough, what ends up happening with Ancient Apparitions is usually you'll just kind of leave them behind in the base to fire off the ultimates, but Lanham's saying, no, I don't want that. I want to be able to level up. I think the Ice Vortex is going to help us. I'm going to participate in these fights.
Yeah, we've seen a lot more Ancient Apparitions being a bit more combat-minded and not just relying on their ultimates, but being in the middle of the fights, throwing down multiple Ice Vortexes, and sometimes Chilling Feet. We're going to have the Aghanims almost complete for Moonmeander, and this will be the next significant upgrade for OG. They can get that constant nighttime vision and kind of stem the flow of ganks that have been coming from Ehome. It'll help slow down the game enough that perhaps No-Tail can get his full carry build out.
Yeah, and you're going to see why this Hand of Midas has paid off so well for the Night Stalker. He's almost caught up in levels to heroes like the Windranger and the Doom. At one point, he was three full levels behind. Now he's actually not that far behind. He's almost got the Aghanims completed himself. And they need the vision game to work out for them. This is such a dangerous position to be in when you're playing against a bounty hunter and you're already behind in the game. Vision is where it counts.
No-Tail and Crit hiding in the jungle right now, waiting for, looks like they're just going to TP out. Ehome did just lose their Aegis, though, and that's probably what they're coming in for. If they could actually get the lockdown on CTY, that would have been a big pickup, but CTY just a bit too quick for that.
He's also got the BKB.
True.
Still a 10-second charge. He might have anticipated a fight, but No-Tail blinks in!
He managed to get the combination off. CTY still has his blink away, though. They just have no follow-up after that. If Miracle comes in and throws out chains, it'll just be a BKB blink out.
I think that's what they were hoping to force. But CTY, completely calm under pressure, realizes it's only those two heroes. They don't have enough burst damage to kill him at 1200 HP. Meanwhile, his team is going to go for this bottom lane push because they've revealed themselves in this top lane. Kaka's even here just in case Moon tries to TP out or anything like that.
He's going to keep the track eye on him. Shiva's now complete for the Doom. And CTY is actually going to make it in. Moonmeander needs some help, but he's not going to get it in time. It looks like the Ice Blast clips him, and that'll be the end. No-Tail comes forward, but CTY still has his BKB, daring OG to try and fight him at this point. He's actually going to blink forward. Fly sitting on the side here, does have his Tombstone. Great BKB charge out from CTY, but no! The Sonic Wave completely whiffs that one. The Shadow Shot comes in, they'll finish up Crit, but it's a return kill on the Bounty Hunter. No-Tail's now trying to get away, but CTY
one
step ahead
now.
Of him, and now Miracle's got to get out of here before the Doom. Will be able to slip away. CTY can't catch up. Maybe Old Chicken can. He's looking for the Shackle Shot right now. CTY, just shy of Miracle. He had one too many remnants.
Yeah, with three dead from the side of OG, Ehome definitely wanted to continue to push the tempo. CTY, great BKB timing, and this is the strength of the BKB against the OG lineup. It was meant to be a trap for them, but as soon as that stun toss gets expended, the Queen of Pain says, there's absolutely nothing for me to fear. Even whiffing on the ultimate, I think?
Yep.
But it doesn't even matter because they have enough damage to kill the Wisp, and that's what you need to do in this combination. I think Ehome understands that because oftentimes you see they completely ignore No-Tail. They try to clip him with any surrounding spells, but for the most part, their priority is kill this Wisp, and then we'll deal with everything later.
And until the Tiny really has his completed Aghanim Scepter and even AC, or in No-Tail's case, might be Butterfly, he really won't be a dangerous right clicker. It's just his magic damage that would be a threat to Ehome, and that's why they're always able to leave him for last. Miracle's going to be caught by the Shackle Shot, the Ice Blast over the top. Miracle, he goes down again. Old Chicken, he is just finding all the control in this game that is allowing Ehome to slowly but surely close down the gate.
He has such a rough early start cap that we talked about when he started the game like 0-4 or something like that, mm-hmm. But he's found his pace back into this game in a big way. The rest of his cores too are steadily just kind of pushing the net worth lead further. The Queen of Pain's already at a monstrous 14,000. Almost has the AC now, and what Ehome are waiting for is going to be the Aegis, and then from there they'll try to broach the high ground. They only have tier 3 towers left to get through as they've taken out all the outer tier 2s. The good news for OG Cap is that there's going to be a lot of items that flood in shortly for them. The Ember Spirit's going to have the Battle Fury, the Night Stalker has the Aghanims completed, the Tiny has the Aghanims completed, and these aren't insignificant pickups. These are the items that can kind of get you back into this game.
not only big team fighting power, but also turtling power with that Battle Fury on the Ember Spirit soon. But are they going to be able to draw this game out long enough? It seems like EHOME, they still have pretty decent late game of their own. Obviously, the Doom, a direct counter to the Ember Spirit in many ways. Wind Ranger is a perfectly fine Glass Cannon carry, and we've seen plenty of Queen of Pains actually be heavy damage right clickers, especially with this exact build. Orchid, BKB, and now the Assault Cuirass.
Yeah, there are no slouches in that department, and EHOME, even though a lot of their lineup is focused around and centered around fighting, they're doing a really good job of distributing farm and making sure that somebody's always farming one part of their own jungle. They have somebody in OG's jungle too. And OG, I think they realize this. They're going to try to scout things out. They've got a huge flood of items in, as we talked about. And with this Nightstalker Aghanim's Gem, you want to try to push the issue if you can. You've got a perfect angle right now. You could go for the silence on old 11. The rest of the team a little bit further away, and the smoke's going to get popped.
Smoke on this side. Old 11 pings stuff out, and OG will actually retreat. This is their opportunity to force a fight, but they deem it not good enough. They're going to wait for the next pickoff opportunity.
I do like that they went for that. You don't even have to smoke because you have the Nightstalker leading in. He should be able to spot all the wards in the surrounding area. And Old Chicken, he's still smoked up. Roshan's available for them now, and there's no vision of this. And this is what OG was hoping to stop. Maybe get into a fight with all those newly completed items before this Roshan attempt. This is going to be the high ground for them.
OG, they won't be able to get to the Roshan pit in time at this rate, so EHOME will have another Aegis, and as you said, opportunity to go high ground now for EHOME. They've completed most of their big ticket items, the AC just now here. All that's really left is maybe the Aghanim Scepter on the Ancient Apparition. And Old Chicken, he can buy a Chrysalis if he wants to right now.
This is a pretty rough situation to be in right now if you're OG, because of the fact that none of the lanes are pushed in, Cap. If you notice at the bottom, the lane's almost at the tier 2. At top, there's no pressure on the tier 2. And this is going to force EHOME. They're going to look for a kill if they can. They know they're all at top.
They're going to find Moon Meander, but he's the first to TP out. Crit, putting himself in the side shop, doesn't look like CTY is going to find anybody, but they still have better control. Middle and bottom lanes are still pushed in. By the time the Tiny Wisp gets there, EHOME are going to be breathing down their necks at top lane.
Yeah, they've done a really good job of forcing out all the lanes. They even go for the gank attempt because they know the bottom tower isn't pushed out hard enough. But CTY is going to meet at them. He's almost there in mid right now. With this creep wave dead.
Moonmander is making his way in with an invisibility rune. Maybe this can set up a good defense for OG. It's beginning to look like do or die for them. OG already taken a lot of damage on their tier 3 tower. Old 11 thinking about going for the Doom, but cancels it at the last second, opting not to go for Miracle just yet.
This tower goes down so quickly, they can't really afford this. Miracle still doesn't have a Battle Fury. He's got the buyback available, but how much does that actually mean when you don't have any damage to couple with it?
Now it's going to be a melee Rax. OG, are they just giving this up? It looks like it. They're just going to try and trade it, perhaps for a tier 2 tower at the bottom lane, but EHOME could very easily get back in time to defend that. Maybe they just keep on going. Perhaps the top lane, it looks like it. They're going to push out that top lane. If No Tail and this Crit Wisp want to keep on going, they'll take two lanes of Rax in exchange for one. Now first TP back. Wind Ranger's going to try and set things up here with a Shackle Shot, but Crit is sitting very far back with a Relocate ready to go.
Yeah, I don't think you continue to force the issue if you're EHOME. You don't have any TPs back. CTY actually just grabbed one of his own. The Doom still doesn't have one either, but at top,
if caught fly, that'll be a quick kill there, and they didn't even have to expend anything serious. That was just Shiva's, no Doom, no BKB, nothing really big used by EHOME for a pickoff on a hero for 35 seconds.
This top tower's taking a lot of damage too. CTY still has the Aegis, and even without the rest of his team available, he's just going to right-click this down, but
that's why OG has to force the fight. They're going to relocate in, but Crit is immediately the target. CTY is going to be able to get that kill, and No Tail is left without his extra mobility, and Ice Blast is coming in hot. Miracle's going to be able to slip away from that one, but the Shivas will make sure that No Tail's not going anywhere. Now, CTY jumps forward, going to catch Moon Meander as well, pops the darkness, and going to try and stick away. Old 11 perhaps overextending himself, caught underneath these tier 4 towers, and will be going down to all that physical damage, but EHOME have claimed that tier 3 tower. And looking for a little bit more Shackle Shot onto No Tail. That's a setup. CTY throws out the
buyback after this. There's no buyback for 80 seconds. Fly's going to be the next target. Comes back in. Tombstone laid out. Heals himself away. But Ehome focused down that building and will turn towards the melee racks once again. CTY, he is on the front lines with this Aegis, and he doesn't care what OG throw it his way. It's going to be two lanes of racks, and OG on the edge of losing this game one. CTY jumped in. That's going to be the Aegis. Ice Blast coming in now. Does hit two. OG are going to be forced back. Gets a chains out. Kaka just gets a bit more damage. They're hiding underneath that fountain, though, waiting out that Ice Blast while Ehome comfortably take that range racks and start backing themselves away.
And at this point, Ehome no longer care about the split push, even if OG decide to attempt it, just because, well, they've only got one side of their racks left to go. And just at 33 minutes into the game, with no real items on that Ember Spirit, he does finally complete the Battle Fury, but that's not enough to hold Mega Creeps. I think OG is going to realize that, say to themselves, let's just look for a fight outside our base. Don't let them just slowly siege and go for the next Roshan.
Yeah, you may not have that second life on CTY anymore, but look at his HP. He's got 2,100 health right now, with another 28 armor to back it up.
He just casually completes an Eye of Scotty after that engagement. Doesn't have to save for the buyback whatsoever. They're in almost no danger. OG, they had to expend a lot just to be able to defend that, and I don't know if you even call that a defense. It kind of just felt like Ehome said, alright, we've gotten enough.
Bounty Hunter now with Guardian Greaves. We've got a Doom, 3,700 gold there. Is the Aghanim still worth it?
I don't think so.
Just continue to go. I mean, he can't go AC, so what's his next item?
BKB is quite good for him. Mm. I think getting a BKB on all the cores of Ehome is the right step. They've got one completed on the Windranger, because again, he realizes it's not damage that they
Shackle
lack.
Shot coming in, but it's not going to be enough. Moonmander turns around and will be able to get away. And Old Chicken is actually potentially caught out here. Miracle's going to try and go for the dive, but the rest of Ehome are backing him up. Crick gets a heal and will just not be able to get out. He tried to go for the TP, but a Shackle Shot latches him down. Old Chicken is stuck, but managed to get a force to get away. Toss in! Old gone. Chicken gets out! A critical pickoff, and OG missed their mark. Ehome are now on quick retreat here. No smoke up. They're going to turn things around. And Moonmander, he's already dead. Sonic Wave hits on four, wiping out OG. They're just going to lose one by one, and they call it game one. Ehome just destroy OG. No hopes whatsoever. Chinese Dota staying strong here at the Majors.
We talked about how OG was able to get all their critical heroes in the draft, but it's a CTY Queen of Pain. You can't really ever let that go through, and we see why.
Old Chicken had a rough start in the beginning, but he still managed to showcase so much strength on that Windranger as soon as he picked up the Blink Dagger, just controlling OG's tempo all the way. They didn't look in control of that game ever. That means our analysts, they've got a rough road to talk about where OG